I'd like to thank everyone for joining us today for our second in this three-part webinar series. Today, we're going to be talking about additive manufacturing processes and applications. So last week, you received an introduction to additive manufacturing. Today, we'll be talking about processes and applications, and next week, if you're interested in additive and wondering what next step should I take, next week is when we answer all of those questions. So Dave Pearson and Cullen Hilkenin, it's Cullen, I can never get your last name correct.
It's a tough one. It's a tough one. Hilkenin, yeah.
Hilkenin. Just got one of those names. Okay. The two of them are the experts in additive, and they're going to tell us all the ins and outs and what's good, basically the good, the bad, and the getting better part of additive manufacturing and all the different technologies. And then we'll wrap it up. So without any further ado, I'd like to hand it over to Dave to tell us a little bit about himself and MEP.
Well, thank you very much, Connie. Good morning, everybody, or almost afternoon, everybody. Some of you on the West Coast, it's morning time. But what I want to do is talk a little bit about what the MEP embedded strategy is and how Connie and I are working with a lot of the other MEPs in the network to actually bring additive manufacturing into their core competency. And what we're doing is trying to develop a little bit of training and a little bit of best practices that we can transplant into all the other MEPs through the national network, where we can help you guys find solution paths for the small and medium-sized manufacturers. And I like to think of that as the low-hanging fruit. These are solution paths that Cullen and I have worked with for the last 5, 10, maybe even more years. And the goal is really to try and transplant some of those success stories that we have and put that into the national MEP community and let that propagate into the small and medium-sized manufacturers. So some of the resources we have are a lot of additive manufacturing equipment here at America Makes, along with what Cullen has, and he's going to talk about next. But what we can do is, what I like to say, de-risk this technology for a lot of the small and medium-sized manufacturers that do not have the resources to go to some of these shows and figure out what the exact machine they need, what material it should be, what the volume size of the build chamber should be, and all that kind of stuff. What we can do is de-risk that for everyone and give you a paved solution path. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to Cullen. Cullen's going to talk a little bit about 3D Diligence and how they are working with the MEP community.
Thanks, Dave. Yeah, so I'm Cullen Hilkenin, CEO of 3D Diligence, and we are rapid manufacturing services providers. So as Dave touches on, we de-risk access to different technologies from prototype to production. Our business acts a bit like an Uber or an Amazon for rapid manufacturing in the sense that we have qualified a network of partners across North America with all of the different 3D printing technologies, or I should say just about every technology we'll discuss today, as well as processes like urethane casting, injection molding, and also CNC machining, so that we can support customers dependent on whatever their nature of their project is with expertise across the board. And the origins of our business were particularly oriented around 3D printing, where we said there's such a wide range of different solutions, so many different materials, so many different processes, and so many different places, frankly, that it's far better for us in terms of customer support to be able to dynamically access whatever is the right solution rather than whatever solution happens to be in the warehouse or on the factory floor. So with that said, we'll dive on into additive manufacturing today and a breakdown of the different process families of additives. So the ASTM F42 committee aligned around 7 major process families. We'll touch on them today. Yeah, go ahead, Connie. I'm sorry.
Second, one thing I forgot to mention is if you could turn off your video, if you do have the video, put your phone on mute. And we'll be taking questions at the end, so if anyone has questions at this point in time, you know, just put them in the chat message point, and I'll collect those, and we'll discuss them at the end. So, Colin, I'd like to hand it back over to you.
All right. Thanks, Connie. So, yeah, as we were discussing, there are seven major process families when it comes to additives. So some folks may have been confused based on headlines or based on where maybe some of these investment announcements are coming from, that, or for that matter, having been in the industry for a long time, oriented around kind of an assumption of what additive manufacturing is. In fact, it's these seven different major process families, and within them, sub-processes. We won't have an opportunity to touch on all of this today. And in fact, in terms of how you orient these, depending on the materials processed by different machines, they're capable of different levels of process intensity. So there are many ways to slice and dice how we might present these today. We're going to do it in a chronological fashion. In the order in which they were invented and brought to market. But the main point of this slide is to say, what is additive manufacturing? If we go back just for one more second, Connie, sorry. It is not just one thing. These seven processes we mentioned the number of materials capable of being processed is extremely broad, and it's ever expanding. In fact, there are a number of custom materials that are in development that really can only be processed properly by additive manufacturing technology, and the application set is broad, and it's also broadening. So, you know, the orientation is especially around kind of smaller volume parts and also parts with higher complexity, but as speed, as reliability, as price points are improving, the range of applications is ever expanding, and we'll touch on those specific applications as it relates to different process families in this presentation today. So I think we go on the next slide now. So the first process that we'll be touching on today is vat photopolymerization. So this was the original 3D printing technology invented in the 80s. And it is the process of taking a vat of photosensitive resin and then curing that resin through selective exposure to light. And that light can be by way of a laser, or it may also be through a projection that can cure a whole layer at a time, as opposed to an etching, which is done with the laser. But in either case, it's initiating polymerization to create this part in a layer-by-layer fashion, with that platform upon which the polymerization is taking place moving up or down inside the pool of resin. Strengths of this process, it is highly accurate. 25 micron layers is how low it can go, depending on the machine you're using. It may or may not be able to get quite that level, but generally speaking, highly accurate, very smooth surface finish. The parts come off feeling very much like injection molded or cast parts. Because it's been around for a long period of time, the range of different size options has evolved. So there are some very small stereolithography printers. In fact, we've touched a little bit in micro stereolithography printers where you can actually get even below 1 micron. We reference the 25 microns here because that's kind of broadly commercialized. But it also goes much larger than that, where you can have a few feet in the XYZ. The resins also, by way of this process, tend to be a little bit more durable than the ones using the material jetting process we'll touch on in a few slides, which is also a resin-based process. Some limitations of this technology, though, because it's a pool, the parts have to be supported during the build to some extent. That means inclusion of supports in the build. And those supports have to be removed. Also, because it's photosensitive material, it does have to go through a post-process UV curing step, which takes some time and can be messy. And then as we talk about materials, while these are a little bit more durable than some of the PolyJet resins, nevertheless, thermoset resins on the whole are prone to more limited application sets, can be more brittle than formal thermoplastics. Although there are a number of people pushing the edges of that technology, and so that is evolving. Applications that we commonly see: fit and form testing, creating casting patterns, And as we touched on, emerging functional applications is some of the material science evolves in this space. The last thing I would mention, too, that I don't think is included on the slide, because it is a vat, one material is all that you're capable of processing at a time with this, unlike some of the multi-material processes we'll touch on in a few slides. So with that, I'm going to hand it to Dave. Dave, if you got any other color on this, please feel free to throw it in, or we can jump on into the case study.
No, the case study is fine. That was a great introduction of that photopolymerization. I think the only thing I would just maybe reinforce there is we're still working in one material. We don't have support material and model material. We have model structure and we have support structure. So that's the key takeaway from that photopolymerization. But moving forward, one thing I'd like to talk about when we're talking about applications for additive manufacturing is a couple analogies I use. One is actually I harvested from Terry Wohler's, where he references, in order to find the riches in additive manufacturing, you have to find the niches. And Invisalign is really a company that embraced that substantially. When you think about looking for a valid application for additive manufacturing, I think of a tripod. And the tripod has to have three solid legs to stand on. One of those legs is the material properties that you need. Obviously, some of these machines aren't going to be high temperature, they're not going to be high strength, they're going to be adequate for certain applications. And that's really what you have to find, that little niche where you have the right material properties for your needs. The other one is the equipment, making the right equipment with the right material and the right application. Those three really have to be solid legs in order to stand on a valid cost justification for utilization of additive manufacturing. So this example, I reference a large amount because when you think about manufacturing of these dental Invisalign mouthpieces, every single one of them is different. So we're transitioning from mass production into a mass customization environment with these. Every single part that they put out is going to be different. So from a manufacturing standpoint, what we've done, we've transitioned out of mass production where Henry Ford is making a black Model T with the exact same options and just a different serial number every 3 minutes. And now we're transitioning out of mass production into mass customization. And this is just a perfect example. So the next slide gives us a little bit of a snapshot into what that environment looks like when we're actually making these dental appliances. So that picture on the right side there is actually exactly what it looks like when it comes out of your stereolithography machine. That tray is porous so that the vat and the materials can flow into that area freely and easily. That's exactly what it looks like coming out. I used to say that parts can be messy when you're post-processing them, but that's quite a little bit of a lie. The reason why they can be messy is if I have to do it. Usually I have my interns do all the cleaning for any of these parts because it is so messy. It's fairly quick, and as Colin indicated, it's very accurate. So this is really one of those sweet spots where we found the niches and somebody is harvesting riches by using additive manufacturing. So this is really a lot of what Connie and I are working on is developing strategies for companies to find those sweet spots for them. You know, we're not going to print everything like a Lego block and be cost competitive, but something like this is absolutely the right application for additive manufacturing. So I think that concludes my dialogue on a quick snapshot of additive manufacturing and SLA, and I'm going to turn it back over to Cullen to talk about powder bed.
Perfect. And real quick, Dave, as I hear you mention the term SLA, I'll also highlight the fact that The ASTMF42 committee aligned around these seven major process families. I highlighted that there are sub-processes within each of these families. So, for instance, the laser-based technology is called stereolithography, sometimes shortened down to SLA as an acronym. The process using the projector is commonly referred to as digital light projection, so DLP. So you'll hear some acronyms floating around, and that can be one of the challenges here of understanding all the different technologies. And Dave and I, being so deep in this, we may fall into using some of those acronyms on occasion. So as Connie mentioned also, if you hear any letters thrown out of our mouths that you may not process, please make a note, and we'll be sure to come back and clarify at the end of the presentation. So
yeah, I was just going to add to that, Colin. Some of these classes that I teach, I actually have an acronym cheat sheet that goes in with my presentation, just because there's so many different acronyms that get thrown around. So thank you for the clarification there.
Yeah, absolutely. And I should mention there are a few more branded acronyms on top of that in that VAT photopolymerization family. So that's why we may not touch on all of them. But with that being said, we'll shift gears now into powder bed fusion. And as you'll see, powder bed fusion has certain similarities to the VAT photopolymerization process in the sense that it is using a laser. But in this case, that laser is being used to selectively fuse together particles of a powdered material. So in this case, laying down one layer of powdered plastic or powdered metal, and then hitting the parts that you want to solidify with a laser, or actually one of the emerging technologies is a chemical binding agent that can start a binding process through the application of heat. This is one of HP's new multi-jet fusion technologies. So the powder bed fusion family, again, broad, many different subcomponent processes, but underlying point being lay down a layer of metal of material that is in powdered form, typically 20 micron beads across to maybe 100 micron beads in diameter, and then finding a way to apply heat or a chemical agent to fuse those particles together and leave alone the parts that you don't want solid. And then do that layer by layer, putting down a whole layer of powder each level as you go up until you have a part that's encased in a cake of loose powder. And then that can be removed through a post-processing set of steps. Strengths of this process: superb design freedom. Okay, like by virtue of that loose powder being in place as you're building, it provides a bit of support in a way that loose resin, that liquid resin, doesn't for the levels above. And so, especially as we're talking about the plastics domain, you're capable of achieving geometries that are otherwise impossible. For instance, a collection of subassemblies that all work together that can have different components interfacing with each other, for instance, hinge parts, that can be printed as assembled, so long as you can get that loose powder out. Additionally, durable parts. So this process runs across thermoplastics as well as metals, so as a general rule, quite durable in terms of parts. And pure material properties. This is using a single material as the powder base for the process. So you are getting pure material properties. We'll highlight this as a reference point for some of the other technologies, particularly in the metals we'll touch on earlier, where you may have mixed material properties. Limitations of this technology. So the number of plastic options are pretty limited. Nylon is kind of the king of this domain. There are some other materials like PEK, for instance, BEKK, and there are some composite materials where you've got glass-filled nylons, carbon-filled nylons, but generally speaking, nylon is the go-to material for this process. And then when it comes to the metals, there are a handful of metals that can be processed this way, but the nature of the laser heating and cooling the powder can result in some microstructure issues for certain materials also. So some limitations on the material side. When it comes to one-off printing, you can imagine, because you've got a whole bed process taking place, especially if you've got smaller parts that wouldn't fill an entire build tray, that limits its cost effectiveness for those smaller projects. Some of the other technologies lend themselves a little bit better to one-offs where you don't have the whole bed to be concerned with. Again, we have to make some generalizations here, so it is geometry and part dependent if that's true, but that's a general rule. And then the metal printing process is pricey. If you're used to machining a part, unless it's a highly complex part, you're going to find that the powdered materials can sometimes cost on the order of 15 to 30 times what the raw stock would be for a machining process. And then on top of that, the underlying machines and the machine time is expensive. So all that adds up. With that being said, a lot you can do with this technology: fit, form, functional testing, and then also, as I mentioned, the support created by the loose powder opens the door to very complex geometries. I didn't touch on some of the support requirements that do exist for some of the metal parts. Dave, in the interest of time, I'm going to let you maybe touch on that as you're running through our next case example.
Okay, thank you very much, Colin. Again, well done. My analogy, usually when I talk about powder bed, and I do a presentation in front of everybody from middle school students to C-level people, some of the analogies I use seem to resonate with them and transition this technology to them, their understanding a little bit better. And the one I use for powder bed is brown sugar. So brown sugar is basically sugar and molasses mixed together. So when you were making, think about when you were making Christmas cookies, excuse me, and you're younger, your mom, your grandmother, your whoever, your helper, when you're cooking or helping them cook those Christmas cookies, they went to, or sent you to the pantry to get that brown sugar. And if it was open and that molasses got to dry up a little bit, that turned that normally loose powder into a rock. And that's really what we're doing here. We're taking that loose powder and we're transitioning from that loose powder form into a solid mass. And then as we move forward here with some of the applications, you heard Cullen talk about part density in the build chamber. That middle picture there is what's called a very well-densified build chamber. So that's off of an RCAM machine, which uses an electron beam to impart energy onto the powder bed to transition it from that loose state into a solid mass. So those are actually hip cups. So think about what I mentioned earlier about the mass customization with the braces or the Invisaligner. Every single one of those is different. Well, all of our bodies are different, but what we can do with this technology is actually start to customize the hip cups and other parts of the body that have metallic implants, customize those metallic elements to be very close to your body. So instead of a surgeon buying a kit for small, medium, and large, he can buy one for the Dave left or the Cullen right hip cup or fill in the blank, whatever you need. So what that does is it reduces the amount of adaption that the surgeon would have to do on our bodies, and it allows him to get the parts to fit much, much better. And at Magnet, we do some skull printing for accident victims that are very much one-off parts that we're taking information from the actual CAT scan of the patient and developing geometry, and then that goes back to the surgeon for implanting into the body. So very, very capable technologies for medical applications. Next application we have worked with is on making heat exchangers. So a lot of these pictures are general and cartoon-like, basically because myself and Cullen work on projects where there's very, very restrictive NDA, so we can't show you any of the pictures. So this is a very generic representation of some of the work that we've done in the past where we take and utilize the capabilities of additive to develop heat exchangers that are extraordinarily high performing. And by extraordinarily, I mean we can cut the size down to a quarter and still achieve multiple levels of performance increase. So we're reducing weight, increasing performance. There's also going to be a little bit more cost associated with that, but in certain applications, that's irrelevant. mostly in aerospace and some other motorsport applications where you don't have those cost restrictions. But a lot of what this technology does is trickle down into even more, let's just say, conventional applications. So this heat exchanger, what we did, shrunk the size, increased performance. Next application is actually a fuel injector that GE has developed to actually greatly increase the performance of the fuel injector. And I love it. The animation is working, Connie. So well done, whatever you guys did. The last time I looked at this, the animation wasn't working. So they are so secretive about this GE LEAP fuel injector nozzle. I kept asking them for any information. Zip. I mean zip. So and I went pretty high up into GE to try and get information. So what I ended up doing is just thinking about it, and I realized they patented this fuel injector nozzle, and I went to the USPTO and did some searching for the GE fuel injector nozzle, and those are patent drawings. So I didn't steal anything from GE or play games to get those drawings. Those guys actually submitted to the USPTO, and that's where I got them. So the highlight I like to point out here on this bottom right picture is those holes. Standard fuel injector airflow is straight holes, and of course they're round because we have to drill those holes with a drill and spin the drill. So one of my standard monologues in a design for additive class is, why do holes have to be round? Why do they have to be straight? So what's happened here is a lot of these constraints come off when you're designing a part for additive manufacturing. And what you see here is really the poster child for production parts being manufactured exclusively in an additive manufacturing environment. That injector is, I think it's 5% more efficient than the standard injector that they had, and it is a combination of 19 parts being put together into one. So very, very complicated part. A lot of different pieces, parts that were brazed, welded, assembled together. And what GE has done is completely transitioned this marketplace by optimizing that fuel injector nozzle. And basically the epitome of finding the niches to find the riches. So they have watertight IP on this, and they are moving forward with an extraordinarily capable product, and it is 100% printed. So that's my quick monologue on examples for metal printing, and I'm going to turn it back over to Cullen, who's going to talk a little bit about binder jetting.
Yep, great comments there on that powder bed fusion process, Dave. And I think, you know, I'll to close that out, just mention that, you know, we touched on it, that these powders are more expensive, but if you can take full advantage of the technology, as you saw with a few of those application examples from Dave, it becomes a viable technology not only at the prototyping phase, but also in production, because you're able to deliver far greater performance, whether it be integrating with bone structure and accelerating bone ingrowth, or whether it be reducing weight requirements and improving efficiency of parts in the aerospace industry, as we saw with GE. So moving into binder jetting, this process will resemble powder bed fusion quite a bit, in the sense that you're laying a layer of powder down on a build tray, but instead of hitting it with a laser or an electron beam, or as we mentioned, those chemical agents to create fusion, instead we're basically hitting it with glue. So as you're laying down this this bonding agent one layer at a time, and this is being done either with metal powder or typically with gypsum powder, so like full color sandstone, we can not only bond that those little powder granules together, but then also in the case of the gypsum sandstone example, you can also apply colored agents, so that allows for a part to be built up, what's referred to as a green part, that is very fragile because it's just powder held together with glue. I should mention, too, that some is being done in the ceramic space using this process as well. So, again, a very fragile part out of that first leg, but then there's a secondary step with regards to these parts where typically you can dip that part in super glue to kind of give it a bit of extra strength, or in the case of metal, you can put it into a furnace and either sinter that part fully or alternatively infiltrate it with another material at a lower melting point. So the strengths of this process, number one, fairly accurate, especially on the binder jetting side with the gypsum powder. When it comes to the metals, you can encounter some shrinkage challenges with that furnace step, but certainly affordable. I think that's really the main thing I would highlight with this process. If you're looking for quick modeling concepts, then if you're just using glue and some ink, you know, it's a heck of a lot cheaper than high-powered lasers. Similarly, if you don't have the need for pure material requirements and it's okay for you to infiltrate a stainless steel with a bronze, for example, it's a heck of a lot cheaper to use a combination of glue and a furnace to and a whole bunch of raw material stock that just needs to be melted rather than a whole bunch of powdered metal and then also high-powered lasers or electron beams to do all your melting. From a limitation standpoint, and I should mention too, from a strength standpoint too, good flexibility on a design side as well, because you have that loose powder support as built into the process. In terms of limitations on the gypsum side, certainly can be very brittle. These green parts in general, very brittle. And then on the metal side, unless you're doing full sintering, which is a process that frankly is in the early stages of commercialization right now, and you're doing the more conventional infiltration step, those metal parts are going to have mixed material properties, which may not be viable for certain applications. With that being said, applications, conceptual, potentially fully full-color models, that is the go-to use for the gypsum printing. And then when it comes to the metal parts, traditional casting applications. So again, if you're doing something in a an iron, for instance, and you could get away with a mixture of stainless steel and bronze, you can potentially achieve much much faster approaches with this to complex geometries that have been traditionally cast, or we also see applications in the jewelry industry, for instance, but traditional casting applications with high complexity is a good application for this. Dave, if you've got any other comments, please throw them in. Otherwise, we can jump on into your case example.
No, I'm good. Let's head on to the case. That was great, Colin. So our first binder jetting example that I've got here is a casting application. So what you are seeing on your left is basically sand and glue. That's all we do is put the sand and use that sort of that brown sugar analogy, it's loose sand, and then we're putting an adhesive on it, and then actually printing the core. Rather than making a pattern and potentially have it on wood and having draft angles, and depends if there's any internal crazy geometry, they have some sacrificial elements to it or whatever. Sometimes those patterns can be extremely expensive, and then they're made out of wood. Sometimes they're made out of bend board. The older ones are made out of wood, I've seen, that are absolutely in horrid shape. People don't care for them that well, and all of a sudden their customer comes back and needs another part, and then that wood is swelled up, or it's who knows what has happened to it after it's been sitting. It's usually not in a dry, protected environment. Those things are sitting outside in the back shed somewhere. So they have to remake that pattern and then go through the testing to get that final printed sand core that they need. So on low volume production, we actually are doing a lot of this with pretty high level of success, where we're actually printing the sand and casting the finished metal parts. I mean, the parts, of course, are going to be near net shape, but they're going to be the same type of cast part that you would get out of a conventionally made pattern. We can also print the patterns. Those aren't quite as cost effective, and we're not jumping over as many processes and preambles to the casting process as we are by printing the sand. But this is a remarkably efficient and a capable process, a mature. It is probably the best word I would say. This is a very mature technology and then very large in size. So at American Makes, we have access to an S-Max here at Hometown Products. So I think that's 6x6x10 feet build chamber, or maybe a little bit bigger. I'm sometimes forgetful on the print volumes for some of these machines. But we're going to get the manufacturer a finished casting of the material that they actually would have had it made out of before. So the limitations here are really just your imagination. I'm doing some of these for a customer right now that are going to drastically shift some of their product line. I guess I hesitate there because I can't talk about a lot of this stuff, but it can greatly accelerate and give them more capability. So some of what they're doing is, in a very general form, they're shifting their business model from a high-volume, low-margin situation into a low-volume, high-margin situation by using additive manufacturing. Next slide, where we start talking about some other applications. Top left are basically architecture models. And they're made of plaster. They're not very strong. They're not going to survive a trip in a Pelican case on an aircraft like most of my stuff does. So I don't carry a lot of the binder jetting parts just because they get broken very easy, but extremely cost effective. All we're really doing here is a plaster, a powder, and glue. And in the sand example, earlier slide, that sand is reused. We just run it through a heating furnace, burns off the glue. We can reuse all of that. All we're reintroducing is some new glue, and then boom, we've got it. Same way with these plaster models. We're putting in an adhesive, and usually a cyanoacrylate adhesive or super glue, and then some colorant, and gluing together plaster or some kind of powders. We can use glass. We can do marble dust. We can do basically any type of powder. We can apply an adhesive to it in a very specific way and come out with a solid finished part. So that's a real quick and dirty overview of binder jetting examples. So with that, I'm going to turn back over to Cullen and let him talk about material jetting, one of my favorite processes.
Thanks, Dave. So yeah, material jetting, this is an advancement in our processes. Up to this point, we've been talking about single material processes, save for maybe some coloring variants with binder jetting or that infiltration for mixed material properties, maybe not exactly what you're going for so much as with this process, very similar to an inkjet 2D printing process where droplets of material are just deposited layer by layer. These are UV curable droplets that are cured in process, and because of the different inkjet heads, and in certain printers you can have up to, I think, 6 is currently the highest number, although I've actually heard in experimental cases up to 10, and there probably are even more. You never know what's hanging out in somebody's garage right now. You can deposit multiple materials. So in that top left example, you can see where we 3D printed a replica of someone's liver, where they had had cancer and they wanted their surgeon to be able to see exactly what the metastases looked like and potentially use this as a kind of practice mode for the surgery in advance. So strengths of this process, highly accurate, 16 micron layer thickness, so the thinnest layers that you see in conventional commercial applications, multi-material printing, as we touched on, so you can have a wide variety of different colors for highly accurate models that perhaps, depending on your preference, may pop a little bit more than some of the color jet options we just touched on. And the on-the-fly curing really limits the post-processing requirements for this. So there's a support material that can be laid down in addition to the main body materials, and that material is soluble, so you can get rid of the supports pretty easily without a lot of the mess that's associated with many of these other processes. some limitations of the technology. So tends to be more cost effective at smaller scale. The resins for this process are pretty pricey, and so that can drive up costs, especially as you're getting into larger parts. And in terms of functional applications, more limited than some of the other resin technologies by virtue of the fact that these materials do need to be jetted through these inkjet heads, and so the viscosity can impact how possible that is. So some of these thicker type resins may not be a viable option, and related material properties tied to that. In terms of applications, smaller part fit and form testing is a particular application set for this technology, and then short run molding inserts as well. Given the high accuracy, you can print these, use this process to print inserts, which can then be used for short run injection molding applications. So with that, I'll hand it back to you, Dave, with some examples.
Well, thank you very much, Colin. What we've got on the top left, you guys heard Colin mention the multiple materials being deposited simultaneously. So one of my favorite examples is that green part. So that is basically an epoxy material that Objet has. And when most of these machines have 8 print heads, each one of those print heads has 96 individual inkjet deposition orifices. And so all those are controlled by, of course, the printer and the computer. And so what we've done here with the top, those green parts, is actually print an A and a B epoxy. So we're not mixing the materials prior to them meeting on the actual print platform. It'll print the A epoxy, the B epoxy, and then, of course, the photoreactive polymer. And what happens is you get basically a part about 30% of its ultimate strength out of the machine. So we can handle it, we can post-process it a little bit, either through heat treating it, going through a heat cycle, or time. We can greatly increase the strength of that part to be actually capable of doing some injection molded tooling. So that bottom slide actually has a picture of an inserted tool into an injection molding machine. So that green material is not going to last for thousands of parts. We're not going to make production Lego blocks off of that. But we might be able to get you 50 parts, depends, maybe 5 parts, very quickly of the native material that you're going to be making the part out of, very quickly too. So if you think about even a soft tool, if they're going to CNC a part or a tool out of aluminum, that tool might take, who knows, could be 6 weeks, 4 weeks, 10 weeks. Those parts in the top right were printed in about 4.5 hours and at a very reasonable cost compared to the price point of a standard tool, hard tool. This is just a real quick example of printed tooling coming off the polyjet or object material jetting process. next example is a very interesting company called Normal. And I used to have a coupon for them. It was $199, and it's that coupon gets you $100 if you zoom in on it. But their whole business model is mass personalization. So that app that you see there on the phone is actually photogammometry. So what they're doing is putting a quarter there and holding that quarter with your finger for reference, and then what they do is take some sketches and references for your ear and develop that internal part for your actual personal left ear, right ear. So Colin or myself or Connie or whoever can take a picture of their ear, send it, that picture via the app to Normal, and actually have a printed earphone that is absolutely perfectly fitted to our ear. So the counter to that would be Steve Jobs' presentation on the Apple earphone, where they're putting that earpiece in 1,000 different people and testing how it fits. So that means that you're getting a lot of compromises there. And one of my favorite analogies is actually an old Porsche ad that I love to reference, where The classic line from Porsche is they have a 911 sitting there, of course. And then they said, compromise is for politicians. And I reference that when I lecture and use this slide, because why should we compromise with the fit and comfort level of the earphones that we all have in our ears all the time if we can have an IFR, or what I call an ideal final result, by using some technology and some advanced manufacturing techniques to get you something that's going to plug in perfectly. So that's really a great niche that found the riches here with the additive manufacturing process and unique application. So that's a real quick snapshot. And I have a lot more if anybody's interested. But with that and interest of time, I'm going to turn it back over to Cullen and let him take on a sheet lamination.
Yeah, sounds good, Dave. Yeah, with an eye to the clock, because we want to leave a few minutes for questions at the end of the hour, we'll move fairly quickly through these last three processes and their related examples. Sheet lamination is the process of laying down sheets of material and then one layer at a time laminating them together. So in the case of paper, this can be done just through a conventional gluing process. In the case of metals, sound waves are used to create a vibratory effect that creates bonding between the layers. But then those respective layers are laid down a few at a time and then can be cut on the fly, or in the case of sheet lamination, perforated and then removed through a post-processing step. Strengths of this process, so on the paper side, affordable. I mean, your input costs are those pieces of paper and then full color ink, so that makes it cost effective. On the metal side, it's a low temperature application. There's no heat that's being applied during this process, and so there are certain applications that benefit from not having had the granules of powder, for instance, very rapidly heated and cooled. No support structure needed for this by virtue of the layer-wise sheet level process itself supporting. Manufacturing speed, so it's actually slower on the paper side. That really references the metals where that can be laid down more quickly. I should mention too, in terms of input materials, carbon fiber is another area that is being explored with sheet lamination, but this is a process that's in the earlier stages of commercialization. Limitations, so particularly on the paper side, lower fidelity in terms of the output and pretty limited applications for paper printing. Post-processing can also be a bear for this process. And on the paper side, it can be a good bit slower than some of the other technologies. And the object's not super sturdy, especially, again, when we're talking about the paper process more so than metal. Applications that we typically see for this, conceptual models and color. I know on the metal side, we don't touch it as much ourselves, but I know there are certain aerospace and space applications where some of the unique properties, especially as we mentioned about the melting and the way that this process avoids it, makes it uniquely suited. So with that, Dave, I'll quickly shift gears to you, and we'll move quick through examples on sheet lamination.
Yeah, thank you, Cullen. So the next slide, we've got a picture of a Volkswagen bug that was actually done in paper. And then that part on the right is the same type of process, or layer by layer by layer. And I have to agree with Cullen, it's extremely time intensive to post-process this part. What you're seeing those two gentlemen hold there is basically paper, and very similar to some of the, sort of the binder jetting / powder bed stuff. You really have to take that part out of the build chamber. Instead of just reaching in through the powder and pulling it out, that has to come out through a layer of paper. So that part came out of the machine in a block and took a lot of work to clean up. So in terms of time, I'm just going to hand it back to Cullen and let him talk about material extrusion, or FDM, as we say.
Yep. Thanks, Dave. So yeah, material extrusion, as Dave touched on, FDM is the branded process by Stratasys. They are the ones that invented this. Although if you look at some of the knockoffs once the FDM patent expired, fused filament fabrication, or FFF, is another term you'll commonly hear for underneath the broader material extrusion family. It's the process of extruding a material through a nozzle that is on a gantry system. So that input could be in a long spool of filament. It could be it could be pellets of plastic material. There's actually emerging metal capability here as well, where you've got metal encased in a thermoplastic jacket. But however it works, it flows through this nozzle, which just gets it barely past the melting point so that it can be extruded onto a build platform, and then it re-solidifies on the build platform. And this is done, again, in a layer-wise fashion, but with just a track of material wherever that extruder nozzle is operating. So this is probably the most commercialized and the most readily recognized 3D printing process. And so, again, we deal in this industry with some degree of letting folks know that there are other things than this, especially because it's caught on to the point where you've got less than $100 machines that do extrusion, but again, at a much lower level by default and with more limited material and accuracy and repeatability capabilities than some of the higher end systems. Strengths of this process, many printer options. I just touched on low input prices in certain machines for the hardware, and then also the input materials also are lower priced relative to the other technologies. And a wide breadth of materials also, because this has been adopted, I would say, the most as it relates to the hobbyist market towards general consumption, because of its user friendliness, a wide breadth of materials from PLA all the way up to carbon fiber. And now, like I said, some emerging metal capability. Limitations, so tends to be less accurate than certainly the resin technologies we mentioned, and then also the powder bed technologies we touched on. A step surface finish by virtue of the process. You do see layer lines more clearly than you do with other processes. As you're building, because it's not putting a full layer of material down that helps support the part as it's being built, but instead you're only laying down material where you need it, that means you do create supports on the fly. And then it is weaker in the Z-axis. That's true to some extent of all additive processes, but certainly noticeable even more so with extrusion, where it's a bit like building a Lego house, and where you can see those little lines pretty clearly from one level to the next. And for that matter, if you were to push on a Lego house from the side as opposed to from the top or bottom, you're more likely to break it. You can see delamination, particularly in that Z-axis of the build. Applications are broad. Functional testing, tooling, like I said, some heavy-duty materials can be processed using this technology, and that opens the door also to a number of end-use applications. So we've seen it used in aerospace parts, particularly non-load bearing aerospace parts, and it serves a major functional role too on shop floors for tooling on the fly. So I know we're tight on time here, so I'm going to be real quick and hand it off to Dave, and then we've got one left to go.
Thanks, Colin. Yeah, real quick in the interest of time, this picture on the left is actually standardly a magnet. We would make that out of metal plates and potentially weld it together, bolt it together. So that picture is a little bit of an experiment to see what we could do by printing it on FDM machines. So rather than a week and a half, maybe 2 weeks to make that out of metal, that's just an over weekend print made of plastic. So we had to thicken it up a little bit, do some slight mods to the design to make it survive with the inherent delamination strength weaknesses that Colin touched on, and then some of the less strength that we have when you compare plastics to metals. But that was a perfect example of finding our niche with additive manufacturing. Then the series of pictures on the right are actually what I call some low-hanging fruit. You know, what we have here is a vacuum forming application, and what we've done in the past to get some better resolution and fidelity on the vacuum forming tool, we'll actually put in vacuum flow channels that would be a little bit tricky to do conventionally. So any questions on that, feel free to ping us, but I'm going to hand it back to Kellen, let him talk about directed energy deposition.
Thanks, Dave. So yeah, directed energy deposition is the seventh and final process family we'll touch on today. It is the process of powder or wire being fed into a melt pool that it was created on a part surface by a focused laser or an electron beam. So some similarities to extrusion, like we just touched on, in the sense that it's more of a point and click. You know, it's really going, we're only deposing material where we want it. This is a very rapid deposition rate technology. One of its key strengths is that it's capable of building on existing structures. In addition to building parts up from the ground, but building on existing structures is its go-to, and significant material breadth. This is done in an open air fashion, sometimes with shielding gas. So that opens the door to some materials. It also closes the door on other ones that are more explosive by nature. Limitations, so not especially high accuracy. It tends to be that speed is the name of the game with this technology, so it jets that powder into the melt pool and results in some not particularly attractive parts, but near net parts that you may be able to post-process to achieve your final end. Applications, primarily repair, and then also building upon existing parts. So if there are features that we want to build onto existing parts, you see the rack and pinion in that lower left-hand picture. Those are machined parts on the left where those teeth have been added. And then on the right where that was just a regular build tray, and then those, again, teeth have been added to it. So, Dave, I'll hand it back to you for applications, and I think we'll have just a couple minutes for questions.
Thank you very much, Colin. Well done. So applications, real quick. What we're with the directed energy, one of the advantages it has is deposition rate. So we can put down a lot of material very quickly, except we really are not that accurate because the powder isn't controlled like we have in the powder bed system. This powder is actually in motion when it impacts with the melt pool. So as soon as the slide finishes loading, which seems like it's going a little slower, what we see is that Aeromet application where we have the CAD in the top left, and then we have what is, I consider, a near net shape part in the center, top center. And that top center part is probably 90%, well, let's just say 110% of the part that you would normally need. So rather than taking a billet and removing material that you might have to remove 80-90% of the raw material to get down to your finished part, what we're doing is we're actually building it up into the near net shape. So we'll be 110%, let's just say, of the part volume, and then we go back in there and machine it to get to your finished part, which is in the right side slide. The bottom there is basically a box. That's what the parts are built in, because the material is blown into that melt pool. Not all the material is going to end up in the melt pool and 100% utilized. So we have to protect the environment, make sure it's in an inert environment, make sure that material doesn't get too far out of control. So the next slide's got some race car examples here. That same thing. We have a very sparse, airy type of geometry that normally you would have to either CNC or manually machine to get that raw material out of there to get to your finished part. So what we've done is basically get to that near net shape and then go in and do the finished machining. So in certain applications, it's much faster. Same as I've said before, we have to find the niches to find the riches. Another unique example of the lens process is that you can actually change the material property or the material midstream. So in a directed energy deposition situation, we can actually blow in, for instance, titanium 6-4 in certain areas, and then put some 3-2.5 on the outside or fill in the blanks. So you have a lot of flexibility with the material properties, and this is one of the few the only one of the seven processes where you can actually change the metallic properties in the process. Mm-hmm. So that's a real quick overview.
Yeah.
The time, I'm going to pass it back, and I think Colin's gonna yeah. finish up here for us.
Yeah, as the buzzer sounds, guys, I know we're right at 10 o'clock. You know, big key takeaways from this chat, and anybody who can hang around for Q&A, we'll certainly hold the line for a few minutes past the hour. But the AM landscape, very broad, 7 unique processes. Don't buy in if you thought you knew 3D printing a short while ago. It's in fact evolved quite a bit in just the last few years. Many material options and more coming on market every day, and it's critically important that if you're going to make an investment in this space, you really need to dig into the trade-offs of these different processes and actually get into the subfamilies, even one level below the families we talked about, or maybe 2 levels below at a branded level, to make a wise investment. So hopefully with the combination of the overview and the examples you saw today, you have a view of all the different applications possible and can find a technology that works for you, or utilize a service like 3Diligent or your local MEP center to help guide you to the right place. So with that said, moving to our next slide, Connie, let's tell them about Webinar 3 and then we can open up for questions.
All right. Thank you, Colin. Thank you, Dave. So for everyone on the line, as you can see in the slide, our next webinar comes up next Thursday at 12 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. And it's really going to answer some key questions about if you're interested in additive or you think it might be a fit in your facility, your application, what are some next steps that you should be taking? So with that, we did get a few questions. One of them, I don't know, Dave or Colin, either one of you would like to speak to this. As far as the time for the Invisalign printing versus machining from a solid with a high-speed CNC and plastic, you know, any idea what the time difference was?
I don't know, but I know we're taking one step out of that process. Let's just say that the high-speed CNC out of plastic or whatever it is going to be the same as printing it. The one key element there that we don't have to do is generate tool paths. So there's some inherent intelligence in the software that can actually take that CAD file and bring it into the machine. And I'm not exaggerating. I can take a CAD complicated piece of geometry and drop it onto the build tray of multiple different machines and basically click print. So I think if we just do sort of a procedure review of getting the CAD cleaned up, putting it in the environment, generating the tool path, running it, and then maybe some post-processing, if all those that I mentioned were about the same, the one key that I can just pull out of the CNC tool or process cycle that doesn't exist in the additive manufacturing cycle is the generation of the tool path. So that's just a quick response.
I'll build on that too, Dave, just to highlight the fact that beyond the speed component, I mean, if you think about the organic shapes and also the thin-walled nature of those Invisalign, gosh, I've drawn a blank on what you want to call them, but, you know, the mouth molds. So the number of tool changes that are going to be required to get to that level of granularity that you're going to need to be operating at least 5 axis to kind of get into some of those little niche-y areas of the teeth. I mean, in addition to just the sheer amount of machine time to actually capture all those details, you're going to be dealing with quite a bit of scrap for every one of those parts too. So it really lends itself perfectly to the stereolithography process, especially if you can do it at scale across an entire build tray where you've just got a laser etching out the exact shape and you can massively expedite the turnaround time.
Okay, great. Thanks for everyone online. If you have questions, please drop us a line in the chat box. Another question for you. So you talked about 7 technologies or processes. Do you see any of them that are used more often than others in a manufacturing type of setting, particularly when we're thinking production? Or is it all really split up all over the map?
I would actually chime in to say, I think, and Dave, so we touched on, I mean, the stereolithography has come up with a number of application sets. I think on the metal side, certainly we see more of the powder bed fusion because in production, the material properties there, I think, are good. I know also the binder jetting, at least to create sand cores, has a pretty good application set. But I think when you talk about some of the material jetting, the material properties there really limit its application set when it comes to production. Some of the binder jetting options, at least on the gypsum, you know, that's more limited. The binder jetting tends to be more of a path to creating molds, or for certain applications you can do the infiltration, but that's my two cents. And then the directed energy deposition, less so for production applications, save for some very kind of unique large form prints, like you know, rocket nozzles and that sort of thing, that they're playing around on very small volume levels. But typically DED is more for adding features or repairing parts as opposed to production applications.
Okay. All right.
Dave, does that jive with your experience as well?
Yeah. I mean, I could go into that. That's a pretty deep question. So in the interest of time, I'm going to leave it with that response from Colin. Yeah, but it's all over the place what I see.
Yeah.
All right. Well, let me ask a different question. We've talked about the seven technologies today. Will it always be seven, or is there something else that's in development that we'll see in the future? What do you, crystal ball?
I can touch on that one a little bit. I see a lot of hybridizing where we have, mixtures of technologies. For instance, and I know some people are going to understand this, but Colin and I understand it. But for instance, the impossible object. Those guys are sort of merging LOM with powder, and getting some remarkable parts out of that build process. So I see a lot of hybridizing where we're using powders, we're using LOM, we're using lasers, we're using DLPs, all that in very innovative, creative ways to get higher speed, lower cost, more robust parts out of the machine. So I don't know if the seven categories are going to expand in the immediate future, but I wouldn't be surprised if they do.
Yeah, I think that's a pretty solid answer there, Dave. I would say that the committee deliberately structured these families to be broad, and so there's a lot of opportunity, and a lot of the recent innovation we've seen is, as Dave touches on, mixing different processes or a subfamily of those processes. I touched on HP's entry into the market with its multi-jet fusion. It's doing powder bed fusion in a different way than anybody did before, but they didn't actually have to create a new process family to capture it, because it's still, at a broad level, is laying down powder and then finding a way to fuse that powder together in a bed process.
Okay. Well, with that, thank you, Dave, thank you, Cullen, and thank you for everyone that joined us for today's webinar.